What's up guys, this is Sean Tan and welcome to a new segment, I hope. Because very rarely you see me asking questions in my own shows, but this is a new series I'm trying to start where we can actually bridge that knowledge gap further, having experts from the industry to share their wisdom or some insider news.
Hopefully.
Today we have Bernard, Mr. Bernard here. Trust me, he's a very, very busy man. He will be here sharing like what he did for his first property and in his position today in a developer office, right? His take on the property market and things like that. So welcome, Mr. Bernard.
Thank you, Sean.
So since this is my very first time, I made some notes. So bear with me. You were in this very conventional industry, doing very new stuff that we consider normal today.
Back when I joined, it was still a fair mix of both. It was still probably more conventional. Probably my budgets were like 80% still conventional. The more innovative stuff was probably like email marketing back then. It was still quite new, right? So we still did a fair bit of your conventional road shows, your buntings, mail drops, leaflets. So that feature quite a bit. Those are extinct. You don't see those. I don't think you see those anymore. Yeah, I joined way before Facebook. I joined in 06. Facebook just launched in 06, right? Globally. They only made their way to Malaysian shores, I think probably 4 years later. So probably 2009, 10 maybe, they became more popular here.
Now how was that journey like convincing all these like, I call them old birds. Hey, this is not the way we do roadshow. Like roadshow will never be as effective.
Well, I think before MCO, right? I think there's a place for both of them. The reason why it stays traditional is because it's unlike a lot of other industries. It's still a fairly physical product. It's a fairly bricks and mortar industry. So there is still benefits and I think room for traditional efforts. It's just you need to balance it out because a lot of the buyers are increasingly spending time online. Right, so you cannot neglect that channel. But when they want to make that final decision and purchase, the conventional wisdom, of course, then they want to see that show unit and so on.
Yep.
That is changing, but slowly but surely it's changing. But of course, it's not something which is overhauled overnight, basically, this sort of buying behavior. Yeah. But back to your question in terms of how was it like convincing? I think it wasn't too difficult. Okay, for me, I had a good experience because my bosses were pretty open. To the viewer, I think Sean and I, we have a quite intertwined past.
We
both work for the same company, him after me. Can we mention the company's name or
not
is
la,
it?
No,
okay, so we work for the same don't want to give free plug. So we work for the same company. The boss was pretty forward-looking. Even in my time at 06, he wanted to set up this website which sort of educates people about KLCC property. So I think it was called klccproperty.com. Nothing terribly imaginative. Nothing terribly imaginative. But again, talk about KLCC, show all the upcoming the projects at that time. So we're working on that, and he had that idea even way back in 06, 07, which was not bad for a MD of a company at that time. So I had bosses who were quite, I think, open to online marketing. So it wasn't too much of a push for me to convince them to put money there. We just rolled out the second time a tool called Microsoft Teams to facilitate a lot of online collaboration. We tried it once, it sort of didn't take off as much. We relaunched it and it took off and then MCO happened. So that tool really allowed us to be able to continue work, right? We did a lot of virtual show galleries, which were quite, people were doing it, but all of our projects had it. So when newspaper came and asked us, are y'all doing virtual show galleries now? Because MCO were like, no, actually all of us already had the 3D VR even before MCO. So when MCO came, it's just a matter of publicizing it and getting people to click to it. So we were quite well positioned, I would say, at Marsing.
Before the first MCO, I see that simultaneously there was like 4 to 5 Marsing projects being launched a lot.
Yeah, before MCO, so end of 09, 019 and 2020, right? Yeah, so we had projects like, I think there was M Oscar launch at that time, right? Yeah, we had quite a few launches.
Like how was it did it affect the sales or things like that?
Definitely we were affected, right? Because the people were uncertain. So, you're a property guy, you know lah. Property is probably for most one of the biggest ticket item purchases they'll make in their lives. They need certainty in order to commit. So, appetite is there, people were still inquiring, but pulling the trigger, that one, they will wait and see. So, we saw a fair share of that as well. Our sales and bookings did immediately after MCO, but thanks to the efforts of the team at Marsing, the marketing efforts we initiated, we recovered, I think, to like 80-90% of pre-MCO sales. Fairly quickly, in terms of bookings, right? Conversion into SPA sign, that one, that one's a different matter. That one, you talk about banks and financing and so on. But at least bookings and appetite for our products proved to be quite resilient.
Maybe you can bring us through what was the process, what were the tweaks generally? Because to me, I like show videos for of properties on YouTube. People were still like, hey, I still want to come and touch and feel and see conventionally. It's still like that.
Yeah.
But like the fact that you all show whatever virtual, whatever online Zoom meetings, right?
Mm.
People will still drop their money for your products, I think is, what were the key elements that?
I think what we focus on was trying to make it as easy as possible for people to make that commitment. Right, so again, you know what I mean. Like, I don't know if I should be saying it because it's a gray area. That booking fee you pay. Indication of interest. So of course, developers were lowering that fee. Same with us. We also made it easy for that to be transacted online through various online payment channels. So that definitely helped as well. But of course, those were just small measures, lah. Right. I think ultimately, what made the big difference was. We went very heavily, like you said, people can't see and touch in the sales gallery, right? But they still need to see something.
Yeah.
And brochures or static images were not sufficient.
Mm.
So we really got our teams, through the various project hits, to go heavily into content marketing.
Mm.
So your videos were used quite frequently as a source of inspiration. See this young guy, so do like that. So a lot of them were doing their vlogs and doing their guided tours.
Yeah.
And our in-house design team, we sort of taught them the best practices of, you know, camera work, videography, lighting, that sort of thing.
Okay, so generally when you say like people do still book, right? But who are these people generally? Because personally myself, I was pretty bullish on this MCO thing. And personally as well, I did a vlog of me purchasing a unit during lockdown.
Which project was that?
So the one was in Bukit Jalil.
Okay.
So sorry, not your project. But anyway.
the next one better be Masing project.
I just correct a hole and I jumped inside myself. Personally, I booked a unit myself, but then a lot of people was like, yeah, Sean, can me. But people surrounding me were also doing the same. So yeah. I would like, if it's possible, like who are the demographics of your buyers in this day and age? Because a lot of people right still think that, wait until MCO only buy and then when MCO lifted, we didn't see. After CMCO only buy change, then forever no need to buy one.
For those of you who know about Masing, our products are quite, I would say, specific in its target audience. Currently, like at least, we are not doing large luxury projects. Masing used to have factories, shop lots, commercial, everything. Masing used to do everything, but I guess Tan Shi was quite prescient. It was a few years back that he saw the shift in the market in terms of affordability, earning power, biodemographics. And Masing now has made a big shift towards what we call mass affordable. So 70% of my projects are below 700 grand, right? So in the 500-600K, which is affordable for, I guess, urban settings. And most of our projects are strategically located in mature areas. So as a result of that strategy, a lot of our buyers are, of course, your young first-time home buyers. And a lot of these first-time home buyers, they buy not to speculate, but they buy for own use and they buy out of need. So people like this, whether market is good or bad, as long as they are secure, they still are employed, they need that space because they have a kid, they are getting married, they will still look and they will still commit.
Heard it or not, people still buy one, okay? So around this MCO 2.0, what is Masing doing differently to address like this kind of situation right now?
Well, we have launched a new campaign, right? The campaign was launched in January. So it's called Home with Masing. So the premise of the campaign is basically in this new normal where people work from home, stay more at home, the home is ever more important, lah. It's ever more integral to everyone's lives, right? And we want to make it as easy as possible for people to own this home despite the uncertainty. So under this Home with Masing campaign, which runs till end of March, 29 March, we are offering packages of up to 4 years payment free, depending on the project. So up to 4 years, so meaning you can commit now and there's no payments for 4 years, lah. So that gives people that buffer to, okay, you can commit now in 4 years time when things are normal and things, high chance it'll be back to normal in 4 years, lah, right? Then you can only commence with your payments. So of course, it's up to 4 years. Some projects are two, some three, some up to four. So it depends on the project. But we have quite a wide range of projects on this campaign. As usual, we have projects in Penang, you know, Central, Johor as well. Okay. So yeah, your viewers can just check out the website. I'm sure you post a link somewhere on the screen. Yeah.
Well, you know all the tricks, right? But anyway, you guys came out this campaign, right?
Yep.
Was before the MCO or after the MCO?
No, during. So this was in January. We came out with it. We started talking about it in October. Right. So the whole idea of the Home with Masing, actually, if you look at the campaign website or if you see any of our ads, there is a blank or dash home with Masing. So the whole idea is work from home with Masing. Build a business from home with Masing, right? Be a rock star from home with Masing. So it basically talks about all the things that you can do from home if you have the right home, right? Whether it's build a business, you know, do a performance, you learn some new skills, everything can be done from home with Masing lah, because we make it easy for you to own that home.
Probably buying, right? Because the channel, my channel also aims to help a lot of first time home buyers.
Yeah, we were all first time home buyers once,
correct,
so we know.
Correct. Like, you know, like, what something like Chor Lin and that. Can you like bring us through your first property and how you
first property.
How you set your capital, how was the process like and things like that?
Yeah, my first property, I bought it before I joined that company we both worked for. So I bought it sometime, I think early 2006, so 15 years ago. Back then, properties were much more affordable, right? To the young people watching now, I think you hear, so you're like,
that time interest rate like how much?
Oh, I can't remember, I think it was 6%.
Now we are lucky, okay?
That time my budget was 250k, not much. So I was 26 years old, I had just a $250,000. I had choices of landed homes in USJ. In the end, I bought a terrace house, double story terrace house. I think it's 20 by 60, if I recall, my first one. 240k, landed house. Right, so being my first property, of course you don't want to take risk lah. So I wanted completed so I can rent out straight away and then go and quickly buy another one. And I wanted somewhere I'm familiar with, which I stayed in USJ too, so I bought it just like 1 km down the road. And I still own it until now, it's still rented out.
Your take on 2021, bullish or bearish?
Well, I was just telling my staff that when you hit bottom, that you can only go up, right? I think those who've been tracking the property market would know that 2019 was deemed to be the bottom. So if you all recall in Q4 2019, the indicators turned positive. So transaction volumes and value sort of inched up in 2019 lah. So everybody was like, all right, turn the corner already. 2020 should be a good year. And it was set out to be a good year until COVID hit. But now that COVID is sort of, well, being taken care of, we have MCO, where the vaccine's out, right? I would say that once that is sorted out, government says 1 year, we sort of agree, 1 year till 80% immunization. But during that 1 year, you'll see the property market resume that little ascent we saw in end of 2019.
So if I were to have money now, buy lah, right?
Yeah, but then again, you're asking a guy who likes property. I bought two properties last year. So one was an office in Puchong, signed SPA February, just before MCO, office. Then one was, I think October last year, during MCO. So I'm a firm believer in that. Look, you want to time the market, you can go man time lah. Yeah? Chances are what will happen is you'll just wait, because there'll never be a perfect time to invest, to be honest.
Okay, given your expertise in digital portion, right? Like you went through the entire Google website and GDNs and SEOs, now Facebook, then now with TikTok.
Actually, we didn't market on TikTok. We did TikTok-inspired content, so it's a bit different. But no, we haven't gone TikTok yet, but maybe in the near future.
What do you foresee? Like, what will be the next mode of buying? Because a lot of people think that my channel is like revolutionary already. To me, it's just
cutting edge stuff. Is like, Elon Musk Tesla thing.
Dude, it's just Tesla a blog. So like, personally, I see VR. Maybe with goggles.
I'm an avid gamer. So I've been around since they were touting VR for the Nintendo. The 8-bit system. Nintendo then had the Sega VR. So I've been hearing about VR for more than 30 years now already. There's a saying about VR, it's a technology of the future and it always will be. Hopefully it will change. But to be honest, until now I have not seen yet a killer application for VR.
Yeah.
Not to say it will never happen, not to say that there's no pockets of application for it, sure. But would it be the next big push for property marketing like how Facebook was? I don't think so. I don't think it's VR. To me, I think it would be, well, it ties in with Industry 4.0, right, basically. So, PropTech, how do you make use of this vast trove of information on transactions, your personal preference, your persona as an individual, as a consumer? How can marketers make use of that to bring personalized recommendations, searches to the next level? To me, honestly, I'm a bit more pragmatic. I think the next big leap would be there when marketers are able to effectively wield Industry 4.0 technologies. So I think big data will be the next big leap.
A lot of people are very scared of social media, very scared of internet because of the transparency. So like that, okay.
That's a nice thing of saying lack of privacy. Transparency. So,
how do you deal with like stigma for that brand? And because this is the one thing, right, where I speak to a lot of people, they cannot crack this code, they cannot release, then they actually lose out a lot. So what would be your perception towards like stigma and things like that?
Stigma of a brand, like a property brand, you mean?
Yeah.
So meaning some developers who fell out of favor and how to claw their way back.
Mm.
No fancy amount of marketing can overturn that, to be honest.
Mm.
Right, we've seen it attempted by certain local car manufacturers. You know, they had this built, what was it? The one where, okay, we don't know which company it is. They had that big monster picking the savvy and scratching his butt advertisement, right? So they had this campaign about build tough, build quality. Doesn't work, not when your product doesn't match what you're promising.
Mm.
The only way back is a long, long road of redemption where you need to walk the talk, service and product. Of course, awareness and branding and marketing can help accelerate that, but it will not replace those efforts.
Mm.
Right? It cannot work in a vacuum. It cannot work if underlyingly you are not improving what you're offering. I think we have seen some developers or even companies claw their way back or made amends. So I think it's still redeemable, right?
Okay.
Consumers still are willing to explore if the price and product quality is right.
Just to illustrate like how busy can it be in the developer's office, right? A lot of people think that in development office, we just build and make money anyway. Can you like describe your key responsibility in like the company that you are in right now?
At Masing, right? Mm. I head two departments.
Mm.
One of them is the one which organized this, the branding and strategic marketing department. So it's a branding and sort of group marketing department. We don't directly handle the sales and marketing for projects. That's handled by people like Chris and the other HODs and PCMs, right? PCMs basically are project heads. But we do marketing efficiency, digital marketing. We also work on group campaigns for the group. So anything which requires a group effort, right? Utilization of certain tools to drive and improve marketing efficiency will be involved in that. Mm. Things like group-wide drive towards content creation during MCO. So we were also involved in that to sort of upskill, share, and help align.
Yep.
Right, so that's branding is straightforward.
So
talking about, I guess, creating brand awareness, the right brand perception, managing our social media channels, keep it safe for all the trolls.
Yep.
So that's under my purview as well. The other department is experience management. That one is more towards driving customer centricity within the company. So what this means is that, how do we put customers first? How do we align our strategies based on what customers tell us? In some companies, they call this the voice of customer program, meaning a lot of surveys, a lot of touch points, getting feedback, and then making use of this feedback to drive operational imperatives and strategies.
Okay, so before the last question, right, is what would be the latest project right now for Masing that you guys are pushing heavily on right now? Airtime.
We just acquired the land. I'm sure you have read about it.
Mm.
Salat Tinggi, 100 acres, M Senyum. So M Senyum will be a new project, landed homes, price starting from 399,000 ringgit, which is a very affordable price. So again, we see where the market is heading.
Mm.
We know that while people like your frills and everything all fine, but ultimately what the rakyat wants nowadays are affordable, well-designed, good quality homes, which they can then purchase first and later expand, renovate, and it grows together with them. Right, so M Senyum is meant to be that. So watch out for more news. We no confirmed date, I think, on the launch yet. We just acquired the land.
We just put in the link down below if you got.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, actually I have to double check on the confirmed date with the project here.
Okay, the benefit of this job is I get to book first.
Yeah.
Internet just gives them enormous information. Like now, Papa say don't want to buy, Agong say buy, then the friend say don't buy, this one buy. Then too many information until they all worn out. What would be your advice, right? For first-time home buyers or things like that.
My advice would be careful who you take advice from. Are they having the track record and success that you aspire to? If it is, great.
Mm.
But sometimes the person may not even be knowledgeable what they're advising in. Hence, that's why people like Sean, who's a property expert, would be a reputable source of advice, right?
Thank you.
That's one. Don't try to predict where values would be 3 years upon completion, 5 years from now, 10 years from now.
Mm.
Buy if at today's price, today's rental, today's yield makes sense. Don't try not to stay in the first property you buy. Right? So I always tell people who ask me, it's like, because property, you have two ways to make money from it. Capital appreciation, right? And rental yield. If you stay in your property, it's literally like going to a boxing match with one hand tied behind your back. Right? In today's world, you want to win, you need both your hands to punch. So you need capital appreciation, you need yield. The moment you stay in your property, yield tada already. You just hope for capital appreciation.
Yeah.
So young people, of course, very I want to stay in my dream home, dream home, dream home. I'm like, dude, you're only like 20 something lah. Dream home will not be what you can afford now.
Yeah.
Right? If your dream home is what you can afford now, it's not a very high ambitious dream home lah. Your dream home can wait till your 30s, 40s, even 50s lah.
Mm.
Right? Think about your return. So try not to stay in the first property, even second property. If you can, try not to stay lah. Yeah? Everything you get, just rent out.
Mm.
Get cash flow in, you can buy more, you can invest more.
That's totally, absolutely everything I preach in the channel. Eh?
Yeah.
So I think that's all for this session. Hope you guys liked it. If you guys have any questions like further for any other developers or for Bernard himself, right, you guys can put in the comments down below. I'll just DM him or email him. For any future episodes, do check out the channel further. And I guess that's all for today. This is Sean Tan. Thank you very much, Mr. Bernard, for
this
very busy time. If you really like this episode, like it, share it, and even subscribe. Do tell us who should I interview next. I'll do my best. Ciao.